camera, by the way, Melissa.
Oh. I just wanted to know if this is from the Lego movie one.
Yeah, the stream looks...
Hello.
Our system.
All right.
We are live and hopefully working much better.
That's good to me.
No button.
No button.
All right. Oh, my God.
If you want to adjust the title there, though.
It's ridiculous.
There we go. We got somebody saying greetings. Right. And we're not choppy. We're not buffering. I hope. So.
Oh, am I just looking at the Twitch
here? The greatest compliment I've received.
You can open up Twitch in your own... browser over here.
Okay, no problem.
Alex, why don't you sit down and introduce us and the things. Apologize for...
If you could throw us on the TV, James, that would be helpful as well.
Yeah, I'll work on that.
Okay, welcome back. Thank you for sticking around. Always the fun things. So, no idea what got said or didn't said to the stream last time. So, if I start just repeating myself, let me know in the chat. And I'll stop doing that. But... Teardowns. So we did a teardown, I guess 3 weeks ago on Sunday. We're going to make this a regular event. So every third Sunday is the plan right now. We'll be here Sundays at 1 o'clock. And we'll be tearing down some toys to really look at the details of how they work, what's inside of them. As well, we'd like in this sort of channel and forum to build some stuff up, do a little bit of design, interact with you guys, the community, and see what are you interested in. Maybe we could have some design challenge where we sketch it up, or just trying to push some toys to the limit, take things apart. This is a fun challenge I want to do, which is, you know, will it 10 amps? Putting 10 amps through any toy. Just
will
turn
it blend, but the electrical version?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What happens if we turn this device up to 11? Things like this, and it might be a good opportunity.
Should it be 11 amps?
11 amps. Yeah, for sure. It might be a good opportunity as well to talk about maybe some active projects that are going on in the community. On the desk here is the open source sex machine.
I think because of the trouble, we're not going to tease this for later. Why don't we,
if people are watching right now,
why don't we talk about the awesome, okay?
Sounds good.
So... there's probably some new people here who hopefully stuck around. Melissa, are we getting any thumbs up to that in chat? So this is the awesome. It is a NEMA 23-based sex machine. I guess that's kind of where we're calling the distinction of what we call an awesome. That and the configuration of the wrap on the belt.
Yeah,
right?
As far as the flexibility of the device, it supports any motor that has this frame mounting style. That's really the core. So you can make it more or less powerful, more expensive, less expensive, sort of more feature or less feature rich, depending on how you want to implement it. As long as it uses this rough body size of motor, that'll all work with the architecture.
And this one here is 140 watt, I think.
Yeah.
And we are targeting the 100 watt, which is why the board kind of stops over here. Normally the smaller motor would be right up against the body.
Yeah, and it's sort of nice. You can, you know, one thing we found in doing this project is really that there is not a one-size-fits-all for sex machines. And the original sort of, I think, design concept for the Awesome or why build another sex machine? Why not just take one off the shelf?
Or modify something that already
Yeah, says, modify yeah. it. Take one and modify it. Is a lot of the sex machines have that very simple just rotary wheel, right? So that's kind of it. So you're a little bit limited on flexibility as far as how you can modify, alter, make that system more intelligent. Even if you add controllers and connectivity to it, you're kind of limited on just changing the speed. So we want to...
Stroke depth is like the biggest problem with the big rotary ones, right?
Yeah.
It's a manual change. Or if we tried to do it with a flywheel, it's a lot more difficult, right?
For sure. And so that was sort of the idea, is how could we make a flexible system that people could tweak, modify, and do more interesting things with? And that's sort of why we came up with this type of concept, and also something that was a little smaller and not like a giant, heavy, you know, contraption.
Some people are making their versions of that, which is great.
Yeah, like
That's the open source part of it.
Exactly. And that's kind of the, going back to it, everyone will have a different set of requirements that they want, need. You know, sex for one person will not be sex for another. And so that's why the NEMA 23, you can have different sizes of motors. For one person, you know, a small motor might be absolutely fine. For another person, like, no, I gotta have 10 times that power. And so I think the Awesome sort of fits in the middle mid range. If you need to be pushing, you know, big bad dragon toys, this you're probably gonna be a little bit probably underpowered for that kind of application. So this is a little bit more in the 80% category of kind of general purpose sex machines. And a lot of that will also come down to is this a vaginal or anal application. And we've done a bit of data collection around these topics, but I think that's another thing that we're really excited to do coming up is collect some real world data from people who have built open source sex machines.
Voluntarily, of course. Yeah, so we're not going to put the data collection in here. Yeah.
Yeah, this is the kind of thing where you would have to like manually go and install the sensor, knowingly do this. There's no like hidden data collection in here. But with the goal of hoping that people would want to share that data with the community to help other people with their projects and just sort of see, like, I would love to see more numerical data on, like, what does sex look like, you know?
Yeah, because we're getting a lot of anecdotal information where sometimes people are saying it's not enough power or it stalls out on this or that, but where?
Exactly. Where and just really be able to see that. So, yeah, this is the Awesome, I think... sort of the original defining feature of this design was the belt pathing. And so this is a design that has a static linear bearing and a moving rail. And the advantage of doing this is that the design is a little bit more compact, where in the extended position, you don't have to have the machine sticking out the back, and in the retracted position, the same thing. So it kind of shortens the length of the device and also allows for this this belt pathing and limits the moving mass. So it kind of just simplifies the number of components. But essentially, we have this is a standard GT2 belt, a 2mm pitch belt, the same thing that you find on every one of your 3D printers. And it wraps around, this is a 20-tooth pulley. And again, these are all just standard parts that you can get off of Amazon. The original goal for the Awesome, and it has held true so far, is that you can buy all these components pretty well next day from Amazon.
Only thing being right now, maybe the servo, depending the servo what country
motor.
You're in.
Yeah, so yeah. For sure the servo motor. The original design was a stepper, and you can absolutely run this with a stepper motor. It's going to be lower cost. Trade-offs will be, of course, be a little bit louder, a little bit slower.
Not necessarily louder, but a more expensive driver. By the time you spend the money on the driver, exactly. The closed loop stepper, you're already at the servo.
Yeah, right? And so that was sort of the thought process. You can absolutely make a very low cost version, but there will be some usage nicety trade-offs. So yeah, these are all sort of Amazon parts. These MGN12 bearings and rails you can get off of Amazon. They're only $10 or $15. The original bill of materials for the stepper motor was around $100. And of course, if you do use the servo, that really adds, you know, basically doubles the cost of the project. So you can make a low-cost version of this. And originally, one of the goals was to make it as accessible as possible for as many people, so that sort of like anyone can build their own sex machine without having to spend, you know, $300, $500 to get it to do something interesting. So that's really the design principle is this pulley rotates and moves the belt. And the ends are fixed on the rail. And so when we move the pulley, that causes the rail to move back and forth. This bearing is not huge. So if you had a very long rail, you could start applying quite a bit of torque to this. So once again, this, you know, if you have a 10-pound toy on the end and you want a 1-meter rail, you know, this isn't going to last that long. But it's proven very robust. I think we've put a couple hundred hours on this system with load testing. And it's been just fine. And so I will introduce just the other part of this project that's a bit more of a recent addition, which is the Awesome PCB. One of the more complicated parts of building an Awesome or a lot of microcontroller-based projects is all of the tedious wiring. And when I say all of the tedious wiring, you know, okay, it's a dozen wires that you have to set up. You have to have a couple power supplies. You need a 5-volt power supply or 3-volt power supply for the ESP. You need a 24 or 36-volt power supply for the servo or the stepper. And then you have to tie the grounds and get the signaling going. And it's just a bit of a hindrance, right? It's a barrier. So we designed just a small interface PCB. small interface PCB that has a 24 to 48 volt input that provides power for the chip, as well as we have an RS 232 serial adapter for programming the ESP, a small RGB LED and NeoPixel. A little bit of power filtering. This is an active topic of conversation. And when doing dynamic motions like this, you can get into situations where when you're decelerating a load very quickly, you're actually putting power back into the system. And that can cause voltage spikes, and so you have to handle those so you don't trip your power supply. The other goals for this board was to have an interface for a physical remote. Of course, with the ESP, you can control it over Wi-Fi or a local network. You can host your own web page with some basic controls on there. But it's kind of nice to have a real physical device you can, you know, touch and feel. Sometimes that's a little more intuitive than having to look at a screen and manage it. So for this build of the Awesome, we have put together a very basic control scheme over Wi-Fi, where it's actually hosted on the internet, if you want to enable that. So you could give that web page to another user in a different part of the world, and they could control your Awesome. Really a proof of concept at this point. It's not high performance.
It's not super like responsive. That. Well, maybe we'll put it in the background after and yeah. Let people control it. It
might be a fun chat interface. Really a proof of concept, and with the hopes that, and it's sort of come to fruition a little bit, that the community will latch onto that and build. We just want to have something out of the box that you can run and works. It's not, you know, optimized, but you can get out of the box internet control.
So with this board, we're just doing one more revision of the electronics, and then we'll make 100 or so?
Yeah. Something 50 or 100 pieces, and then make them available for whoever wants them to build their own. And that way, the project complexity really goes down to plugging the board in. It will come with flashed code, but of course, you can modify it. We're using the Arduino framework for ESP32, so any Arduino code will be supported on here, and then you can hack and mod it pretty much from
and
there.
And the files will be available. You can spin up your own, but we're going to get a little bit of scale for assembly on this, right?
Yeah, so. Exactly. I think it's all, you know, we're happy to, everything here is going to be open source, so the PCB files, all the software will all be available on GitHub, but it's usually not feasible or sensible to order one piece, two pieces of populated SMT circuit boards, unless you really, really want to do all the soldering by hand. In which case, go for it, no problem.
Have fun.
That's, not my personal preference. I'm very lazy. So.
Cool. And this is the prototype remote. This is where we are right now. Have you tried it actually yet?
I have tested the screen and the pot on mine, but I haven't got the encoder.
Okay. So yeah, on that we have, for speed, we're using a pot. The idea behind that is that if you ever need to, you can just quickly turn it to off and it'll stop the motion. Whereas the encoder on the right hand side might be in a different, mode, right? If we were trying to set depth or set the motion, like there's going to be a lot of things you can do with the software that we haven't really gotten to yet. And it connects just with an RJ45 to the Awesome. This is currently actually backwards. Despite checking that 3 or 4 times, it still ended up the wrong way.
PCB design, eh?
Yeah, it always, there has to be something wrong all the time. So,
guys, is the board only servo compatible, or will it support stepper as well?
Great question.
Yeah.
Thanks for asking. Not a planted question. So the interface currently is just step and direction. So these servos take step and direction inputs. So that will work with any motor and or driver that takes step and direction. So the vast majority of stepper drivers are all step and direction. A lot of the low-cost servos are still step and direction as well.
They're just GPIO, so really it can be anything. If somebody wants to use a massive hobby servo, I'm sure we could use a pinout for it, right?
On the PCB, it's just GPIO.
There are a couple of them that are inputs, right? Because we have alarm and step miss on the servo, which is totally not being used right now. It was just there in case we thought we needed it. We haven't found a use case for it quite yet. And we want to talk serial to this, at least this specific servo, just to do settings. There seems to be a bit of a wild wild west out there with this firmwares on these devices, and we maybe need to do some work to unify that, to make it just make it easier out of the box, right? Like,
yeah, exactly. It's really, I mean, one of the nice things about using the servo as well over the stepper is that you can sort of change the feeling of the motor with the tuning parameters. So we can make it a bit softer to feel a little more organic, or you can make it really hard and rigid. And that's a nice flexibility to have, but you have to be able to communicate this thing using its... It is Modbus over RS-232.
Is it?
Yeah. But the way the registers are implemented, firmware varies from model to model, which is very painful. So until we sort of like get that figured out a bit more, we'll have to... That will be a little bit complicated, or we might have to specify what firmwares of the motor you
use. I only mention it because we did put the hardware on there, because I know there are some people who are having trouble connecting to the serial because it needs the true 5.5 volt divide volt.
Yeah, it needs real RS-232, not the USB serial type, which is sort of people call RS-232, but it's really just USB serial, which is logic level. This needs to be plus minus 10 volts in order to actually communicate.
So the hardware exists.
Yeah. So in theory, we're thinking about maybe dumping a firmware as well, just to make a fake RS-232 USB adapter using the board. So you can use the servo manufacturer's tuning software direct out of the box.
I mean, realistically, if you want to run your Christmas lights with this, it's just an ESP with GPIO. Like,
if you just needed a nice ESP board. It's kind of funny. I mean, there's so many ESP boards, but it just never quite feels like they're set up quite right for what I want to do. You know,
and I think that's why we keep adding features to this one.
Yes, the feature creep is real. But I think it's at a pretty nice spot. Even just having only one power supply is, for me, really helpful.
That's the nicest thing, right? Basically, when you wire this up, if you got it, you don't need that. Your only thing is going to be two jumper wires and the plug-in from the wall wart. And that should be it.
Yeah, and then you're running.
So, that's the hope.
That's the hope, yeah. So... Anything from you, Melissa?
Anything from chat about asking more? Okay, so I don't know. So we apologize if there's a lot of you who are already aware of the awesome. We did advertise this stream to Reddit and Twitter, and there may not be some people there who are as familiar with this, and figured we would, as a thank you, start off with looking at the awesome.
Yeah.
Are you guys going to talk about what's on the end of that thing at any point today?
This is... one of the unofficial quick change so the idea here is that this is just a threaded on option. You can put whatever you want. This is the double double, which is our answer to the Vaculock. We'll talk about this a little bit more in depth later when we do the Vaculock testing, but one thing you'll notice is it doesn't have the steps to it. We really don't feel that you need to have the quote-unquote vacuum part of the Vaculock, as well as a hole down the center for cum tube or any other accessories.
And there's, why not the actual Vaculock shape? The original answer was that it apparently is patented, right?
Yes.
And so I have yet to find that exact patent, personally.
We found it, but it might be expired. I'm not a patent lawyer, so I can't talk. I can't talk about that, but yeah.
Nobody knows that, James.
Yeah.
What's it made out of?
PLA.
3D printed
PLA, yeah. The red and, where are we on screen? The red and the purple parts are all 3D printed. The screws you can buy in a pack, like enough screws to do all of this for $19. Some 3D printed parts. Don't know what the cost point on this is going to be, but it's going to be comparable to what you would need to do here. And then you just need a motor and a power supply. And hopefully that's it. I do apologize if Elims is watching. I do not have your great end stop on here.
Shout out to Elims. So you have to tension this belt. And we went through a lot of different belt tensioning methods or attempts in designing. There's whiteboards full of sketches. And then one of the people from the Kinky Makers Discord, Elims, came up with this really nice design that's basically an end cap that you put a screw on. And immediately, everyone is like, yep, that's the answer. This is it. We figured it out. So if you need to ever tension a belt on a rail like this, go ask Elims.
Yeah. Don't forget the bearings.
What about, oh, the bearings, yeah. So, just talking about that. I think Alex did go over it a little bit, but yeah, this is a linear bearing set up. Some 3D printers use it, some don't, right?
High-end 3D printers will use these.
High-end.
Okay.
Yeah.
People who chose to use them.
Yeah.
More expensive than round rail.
Fair enough, yeah. Right? But, yeah, part numbers are on the GitHub. There is a cover design here. This is kind of a revision old in the 3D printed parts. It got a little bit wider than that, but
yeah, to accommodate some mounting features. So I think that's also an area where there's gonna be some work coming up, is better mounting and more adjustable mounting. Turns out, so we took on this project and like, okay, we're gonna solve the electromechanical part of this, and we came up with this, and it was good, but it turns out that's maybe 40% of a sex machine, and the other part is how do you mount it? You know, it's actually a lot of dynamic forces, and so you have to have a pretty solid mounting system so that you're not just pushing this away from your body instead of pushing something into your body. And that is, I think, the topic these days is how do you mount it?
And there's a lot of great things going on in the Discord with
sure.
Adjustable arms and... Sorry, yeah. We have a question.
Oh, he was just saying he's talking about the smaller standard bearings that are under the cover.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Under here, as part of turning the belt, there's a stack of bearings.
Yeah, what some people would call idler bearings that just guide the belt and help get more coverage on the pulley so that you have more teeth engaged between the belt and the pulley.
Yeah, a properly tensioned belt shouldn't slip, but we do have some members who are able to break belts, and they've gone to rack and pinion, which
yeah.
is also completely...
Yeah. And I don't really have a strong opinion on what's better right now. I think both are seem pretty...
I like rack and pinion.
Yeah.
I also like how this belt works on the so.
Yeah, I have no, I'm pretty on board with both.
Yeah.
And the rack and pinion, honestly, printed rack and pinion was about 100 times better than I thought it would be. I really thought printed rack and pinion would last like 3 hours. They would start both like... failing. I thought it would gall almost. Like,
okay,
But it seems to be okay. PLA on PLA from a rack and pinion is pretty good. And I guess we're not putting that much power through it. And they seem to wear quite nicely, are much quieter than I thought they'd be.
It was the quietness, right? From the auto pin that you assembled?
Yeah.
So.
It was virtually silent. So I was very impressed with the printed rack and pinion, even at pretty small tooth sizes. So if you haven't printed any rack and pinion, go print some.
Give it a try.
It's very cool. Yeah, it feels very powerful to have printed rack and pinion. All of a sudden you're moving
arbitrary sizes,
whatever you want.
And cheap replacement parts?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, rack and pinion components can be,
well, I mean,
printed
just
parts
wait,
free.
Yeah, free, but yeah.
Yeah.
No waiting, other than printing.
Yeah.
One of the members just said they're using the PETG on TPU, actually.
Yeah. Okay, so that could do quite a bit for noise, right?
Mm-hmm.
The PETG is stronger, and then the TPU can dampen a little bit, so.
Yeah, I haven't printed a lot of functional stuff in TPU, but I've generally heard pretty good things.
Standoffs is mostly what I've done.
Yeah.
It works. So, do we want to talk about the under pressure thing?
Yeah.
Let's move on from the author.
Yes, the name of our stream today.
Yeah, I don't know if the stream actually got the name. It is our theme.
Well,
yes.
What's the name?
I'm pretty sure I named it.
Excellent.
Ah, okay.
Somebody's on the ball.
Yes.
Are we in frame now? Okay.
Ooh, thank you for this live stream. Any plans to make this programmable with funscripts/openfunscriptor?
Ooh. So, actually, I was just talking with... Qdot Kyle the other day about potentially incorporating T code into the awesome control the motion profiling is a pretty active area and again Elims actually has been contributing a lot to the motion engine for that, and then we have not quite solidified exactly how we're going to interface that with other programs or other devices.
Yeah, T code possibly for X-Toys, and possibly X-Toys is talking about having an API available soon,
mm-hmm.
so we could just hit that back and forth, and that would probably solve a lot of our problems.
Yeah, and at the very least, actually, sooner than later, we should spin a serial interface for X-Toys, because X-Toys has that import any toy over serial, and you just give, like, a JSON.
Yep. I think that was the point of T-Code, which now I'm going to maybe mispronounce your name, Sukabeo. Is that correct? I've only ever seen it written, so I do apologize. They've been working on T-Code integration.
Yeah. And
so, yeah.
Mr. Sonnenbarrel is looking on working the rack and pinion to a 90-degree gearing.
That will be... You know, I'll be very impressed when someone solves that one.
I have pitched that every awesome meeting for the last year and a half.
I mean, it might be interesting to see how... I would like to see a 3D-printed bevel gear. Right? Yeah. Like, let's...
Somebody did a design where they had that very metal, like, all 80-20... Remember, it was almost like a 3D printer, like a XYZ, but it drove the awesome, or like a sex machine, right?
Mm-hmm.
With a beveled gear.
Okay. Yes. They had it, yeah. So I'd like to see if we could do that 3D printed. I mean, just every time I look at it personally and start looking at, okay, obviously possible, right? Of course you can do that. Like, those mechanical mechanisms exist. Either a beveled gear or just like a 45 cut helical gear. The same way that
like a rack and pinion kind of like,
yeah, like
a 45 cut helical gear, exactly, with a rack and pinion,
something like that. Yeah. There's a lot of hypoid gears use something like that as well, right? So totally mechanically possible, and with the right gear tooth profile, I think you can do it with moderate efficiencies. But I just don't think it's going to translate to 3D printed. Like, their precision really matters for efficiency. Sort of like making a worm gear, right? Like, yeah, you can make a worm gear, but...
Or strain wave.
Or strain wave
gear. Which people are 3D printing.
Yeah, like,
so.
You can definitely do it. You might... I just, like, my instinct would be you might not be happy with results. And or we're just going to start building a lot of mechanical complexity. And I love the simplicity of the awesome currently. Like, the way you can...
The bill of materials is so low, it goes together. And I don't think there's a huge amount of disadvantages. And I have been fighting for inline awesome for a long time. He came up with a wrap, another innovative wrap for the belt, right? But you thought it was going to destroy itself a little too quickly.
Yeah, there's also, like, just take the belt and rotate it, right? And if you have a long enough belt, I think that might work. I did make a prototype very early on with that design, but never quite had enough motivation to continue really debugging it. But you can just twist the belt. An inline motor would be quite nice. Would be quite nice.
And as Sophia wants to know if we're going to see it on.
Oh. Yes.
Sure.
Do we have it on in the background again?
Yeah, we had it running in the background.
Okay,
so.
I'll get it set up. Do you want to introduce the three toys and take
unbox? Yep, sounds good. I will do some unboxing. And if we ask James very nicely, he might give you guys the awesome username. So you can go to... app.researchandesire.com/awesome. We'll put the link in the chat, and then you guys can control it in the background.
Would you like to control the awesome? Let me know.
I don't know how that will work with many people controlling it, but we'll find out.
Code is wildly untested.
But it's okay. Nothing can really go wrong here. This is a safe place for it.
Yes. We have many yeses in the chat. Yeses.
All right.
All capitals.
All right. Today... We had been thinking about what topic to do for today, and sort of a number of things around air pressure emerged. So we thought it might be a nice chance to take a look at some of these. I actually haven't seen these toys that James got yet in real life, but some pressurizing toys, so inflatable toys. And the reason that's interesting is it's very small and compact. How do they do that? Are there advantages and disadvantages? And maybe can you use that in other toys? It's always nice to see if someone comes up with a novel solution for their application. You can usually cheat and steal that for other interesting things that you might be thinking about, right? Some compact pump that doesn't inflate a plug, but inflates something else or pushes some fluid or air. So we have one compact inflatable plug. Compact is maybe a relative term. Relatively compact, so this is an inflating silicone bulb. And then we have two, James, these are both the clit suction toys?
Exactly.
Okay. So the clit suction pump style toys. I don't know if there's a real technical name for these.
Nothing that I found. Yeah.
I call them clit suction pumping toys, but there's probably, I'm sure there's a better marketing term for that.
Can
and so
say that one three times fast, though?
Probably not. And so some of the things I'm personally interested to see from the Teardown, a lot of these use a very basic rotating diaphragm mechanism, much like a speaker inside of a sealed housing. But it'd be interesting to see what is the actual air displacement, how much pressure, you know, how much suction are they capable of, and, you know, I don't really know what speeds they run at either. Are these, like, vibrator speeds, or are they much lower? Do they choose different motors or types of gearing to get those speeds and forces are some of the things that I've been thinking about. And so we're going to try and test a bit of that. I think the one thing maybe we won't be testing today is displacement, unless anyone in the chat has a clever way to do that. And I love this this Pornhub ripoff logo. I don't know if they meant to do that, but
oh, you don't. I don't think that was by
accident.
Yeah.
Really? I mean that. If I just saw this, I would assume it said Pornhub. Even yeah. And I go like, oh, it's. You know. Oh, and this high quality bag that they gave us. Wow.
We've got some great instructions here. We have to pass.
We'll give these all to Melissa. I think 30% of the fun for a lot of these toys is really reading the instructions and seeing what kind of wonderful things they ask us to do and not do with their toy. I'll give you these.
Thank you. This one is called a Bendable Sucking Dina.
Excellent.
I don't know if the other one has an English name. Oh, just Sucking Vibrator.
Sucking Vibrator. Okay.
Get to the point.
Yeah.
I can appreciate that, you know, kinky makers. Yeah. Get to the point.
Yes. Yeah. I am a fan of naming things exactly what they are sometimes. Deep Throat Trainer.
Yeah.
but this is why I don't work in marketing.
Sure. Yeah. Oh, can you see the awesome going on with the smiley face? Oh, you probably can't see the smiley face. Maybe.
Oh, that's very good. Maybe a note for anyone. Is this starting in? Well, we'll find out. But don't give it full stroke. I think it's not tuned correctly.
Yes. It is not tuned correctly. I actually don't know how to use the software on card.
Actually, I had the speed on a little higher earlier, and I was like going wild. Okay. So I turned it down a touch.
Feel free to give it full speed, but maybe keep the, or it'll just explode behind us, and that's fine.
That's fine.
Yeah. Do we also have a Lilo on the table? What do
you guys think? This is sort of like a Lilo
knockoff.
It's not a legit one.
Yeah.
These are all like $20.
Yes.
Which is actually pretty amazing when you can get.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
These are from AliExpress?
Nope. Amazon.
Oh, okay. Amazon.
So, like, even Amazon rates. Wow. Like, so, this must be like a $5 toy.
We're still looking for sex toy sponsors. Anyone who wants to, like, donate a toy to us?
Yeah.
We think about making a Patreon?
Eventually.
Maybe one day.
Someday.
Maybe one day.
If we can get our technical stuff sorted out.
Once we're delivering you guys reliable content.
Yeah.
But yeah, if you guys have any ideas for other toys, like, I would love to take apart an Osei 2. To my knowledge, that hasn't been done. If it has, just link it to us and we won't do it. Or
we'll,
maybe
no, we'll
we
still
will
do it.
Yeah. And we'll put 10 amps through it. No one said that. But I think some of these more expensive higher end toys are a really interesting teardown, partially because less people do that. So I think that might be an interesting niche. And usually there's more interesting stuff in some of those toys. And, you know, it's kind of fun to guess what's inside the toy, right? Like how.
Yeah, I guess we should do that part of this.
Oh, sure. Yeah. That's a bit of a staple. Some toys are exactly what you think, and that's very boring. But some toys really surprise you, or somewhere in the middle, you know.
So this is sucking and vibrating, right? Let's see. So, yeah.
And it's got the little anti-gingivitis fingers.
Yeah. I don't know.
The gum massages.
Yeah.
Oh, should we try that close-up cam?
Nope, that's on the wrong thing right now. But I guess we can try it. Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah. Hit close-up cam. There! Oh, yeah, look, that worked perfectly.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah. Get your gums treated right.
It does kind of look like a toothbrush.
Doesn't it? It looks like a toothbrush.
But
I believe it's also for nipple stimulation and an oral sex massager.
Excellent.
Has many uses. It's versatile.
That's a good point. I don't know why.
By the way, I hate these three button interfaces where you have to like hold things down to get into different modes. The vibrator seems to be entirely on this end. Do you want to bring out the new toy? The new tool?
What is the new tool?
Yes, the vibration meter.
Oh, the vibrometer.
Vibrometer, yes.
Oh, yeah. So, yeah, actually, so this was an interesting, amazing find from James. Found this vibrometer.
We don't know if it works yet.
That's not important. But, yeah, so the goal of this tool is, of course, to measure vibration. Because we were talking about, like, one of the things we like doing with these teardowns is really collecting some hard number data, some analytical data about the performance of the toys. So how much current's going into the motor, how much power is it consuming? Because you can tell a lot of things about the device from a physics standpoint by having that. We did some charging data for the last one when we did the wands teardown. And so how do you analyze vibrators, right? This is one thing a lot of people doing reviews will like put in some water or something, but it's one thing also to collect this data, but then how does that translate to how you feel it? So part of the open arousal thing, I would really like to understand how do the different variables of something vibrating affect you? And that's going to be a little bit different for every person, but I think maybe you could develop a bit of a language to translate intensity. Like when you say a vibrator is intense, does that mean the frequency is high or the vibrational amplitude is high? Because those are two very different things. You can have very high amplitude at very low frequency. Vibrators aren't very good at that. Usually more intense only means faster. It's only one tool.
Rumbly and buzzy is the other description, but yeah,
exactly. And so how do you quantify that, and then how can you use those quantified numbers maybe to make better vibrators, right, or use other mechanics?
Yes. If you know what the data is you're looking for, you can target it better other than throwing waves at a vibrator.
Exactly. So actually I was going to suggest, James, you still want to do this? I would love to understand how this vibrometer works.
Do you want to take it apart? You want to do this first and then take it apart?
Does the chat care more about how this vibrometer works? That feels like a dumb question. We should do the toys.
The vote on the table is that we care more about how this works than the toys right now. I don't know how well this thing actually works. What do we got on screen? I can bring it down in. So it gives out a reading right now in millimeters a second, right? So that is, I guess, distance back and forth, because it can also do straight displacement.
Yeah, so my understanding of how these work is that there's a piezoelectric element inside the tip that basically acts as a force gauge and measures how much force you're applying. And usually there's some sort of like a calibrated mass that it's moving. So, you know, if you're applying this much force and you have this much mass, you can get the acceleration from physics. And then if you know the duration, you can extrapolate how far it's moving and how fast.
Right.
So I think that's how it works, but this is a bit of an interesting interface size for me. So that's why I wanted to take it apart, because it doesn't make sense to me personally. Because if I hold it very rigidly, I think that's going to change the reading. But let's see. Do you have the other tip?
You think you want to use that?
I think I would like the smaller tip.
And then Sophia says she didn't know a vibrometer was a thing.
I'm so excited. Anytime I find new ometers,
apparently I don't have that anymore.
I get very excited. I'm sure I took it off and put it somewhere. So that's fine. We'll use this long pokey one. Any new meters? I wonder if we could also make some new meters for testing sex toys. Would be really cool. But vibrometers,
I was thinking of using an IMU with a known weight.
Yeah, that's
right?
What we were talking about was an IMU. And extrapolating for small moves like that, I think extrapolating the position and speed from the IMU data would be pretty good. IMUs aren't good at extrapolating large distances, but small distances are usually okay. And or some sort of optical sensor, I think, would be really nice to measure the true displacement. But
yeah.
Oh, I see. So one end vibrates.
Oh, actually both.
Is it both?
Yeah.
My hand is numb already. Let's vibrometer this.
Let's turn it. Let's again with these interfaces. Sometimes you have to be go through the menu a couple of times.
Oh, guys, I just wanted to mention that Elims is watching. He said, thanks for the kudos.
Thanks for the work.
Yeah, thanks,
yeah.
Oh, he joined Twitch just for us.
Oh, wow.
Amazing.
Wow, we're honored.
Or she. I guess I actually am just sort of naming people.
There we go. Okay, finally got into it.
Okay, the other topic of conversation is do you use this vibrometer from the side or from the top down?
I think you use it like a tuning fork.
James thinks like a tuning fork.
In fact, I think the manual might say that.
I think you use it perpendicular to this direction.
Did we lose the manual?
It's right here. What does the vibrometer say?
0.32 millimeters. Okay, so this actually is different from... Yeah, it's a decimal on a... sorry, we're going to have to tilt this so we can see the screen. Yeah. Very small amounts, under a millimeter of displacement, right?
But and if I push harder...
Yeah, keep going. Still doesn't rise above...
Okay.
Okay.
Out of curiosity... Oh, this is like a dexterity challenge for both of us. pretty close, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It might be like one of those like a center finder, like on a lathe where it's inside, it's like rotating slightly and it measures the displacement on the movement. That way it doesn't matter maybe what direction. Because the main use of this is for like on industrial machinery, trying to find where you're having a bad bearing.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay, we'll do the toys first, and then we'll
tear it down. Yeah. You really need to take this down.
Yeah.
The funniest thing about this is the first instruction is on this thing is, like, don't dismantle it.
Ah, okay.
Which is the first and only thing you want to do with it.
Yeah. Perfect. I'm glad we could violate the instructions so quickly.
So the number we got on that was, 0.7? 0.07 millimeters displacement.
70 micron. That seems low.
I don't know, because it wasn't moving. There was some force. See, this is, I think, where this is going to fail, is we don't have a force measurement on it, right?
Yeah, do you want to switch it over to frequency?
Millimeters a second? I think frequency is across the top, and if it's below,
does it always show it?
Yeah.
I see.
Again, this is not a great interface, or I don't know how to use it.
Can you complain?
Yeah. Sorry, we did say we would never complain about toys. Somebody made a decision. It wasn't a great decision. But a decision was made.
The instruction manual on this thing is so poorly translated that it's actually hilarious.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you tell me how to use it?
As far as I could tell, in the instruction manual, there are no instructions.
How do you,
like, I got the light to turn on.
Okay, press and hold for 4 seconds to turn on. Then there's like a lips. In the power on state, short press the lips.
Actually, we can see pretty nicely on the TV. If you want to look at that.
There should be a low, medium, and high.
So 9.8 or 10...
10 millimeters per second?
Yeah.
And what is that scale reading frequency?
Under 1 kilohertz, I think.
And then is there 20... a W button? That should be the vibration.
Yeah. Well
so far I give it a meter, a 3 out of 10.
Okay, let's just tear it down instead of using it.
I think we should.
So in here, you were saying you think it's just a membrane with maybe like a hook and some sort of rotating cam type linkage that then moves this up and down to make the suction.
That's,
right?
That's my guess. That's my guess. Tear it apart.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah. I think this is all that it is. I think there's a small motor behind that. Whether they have a mechanical offset, maybe, because I'm just thinking about like the shape of this motor. Actually, yeah. So I think you're looking at the motor. This is the shaft, here, right?
I think they like you to zoom
but...
up.
Oh. We were not on. Sorry about that.
This drawing's not for you guys.
Drawing's just for personal.
Yeah, so I think the motor body, and probably the
motor's
facing, it's like somewhat like right over top of it. So if this is the toy, I think the motor body is out this side.
And this rotating cam is just moving the membrane up and down.
Exactly.
Okay. We're gonna like speed tear these off.
Oh,
I should have gotten cool with that. Shit.
You're behind already.
It's a race. Who's gonna win?
get out the traditional. Yes.
James's preferred tool is this fine Japanese wood saw.
We can't see what you guys are doing still, though.
Sorry.
Oh, maybe could we
zoom out further?
Oh, which one is zoom?
The back one.
There we go.
I was distracting you so that I could get ahead.
So yeah, I don't know anyone in the chat who has used this type of device or any questions about how it works. Is this an interesting device? Is this the kind of thing you would like to see torn down? I'm always curious what other people think is interesting because I don't know if I'm always the best.
I think I broke it.
Oh!
Yours is looking a little limp. Yeah.
I think I might just cut here.
You know what would be nice, actually, it'd be like a small scalpel for these silicone tools.
To have the right tools?
Yeah.
I'm sad to say that I've never used one of these toys before.
Sorry, you can't use it anymore.
I know. I might say I want to turn them out before we tear them down.
Your dreams have been dashed.
Yeah.
Or for $20.
Elims knows about vibrometers.
Oh.
It's traditionally used by pressing perpendicular, not like a tuning fork.
Oh, like directly against. Ah, okay, yep. Perpendicular to the surface. Alright, I think that's...
So I was wrong?
I win $1?
Yep.
Good thing you're here.
Yes, thank you.
The Fluke one even has an indicator showing the correct pressure.
Oh, hey, yes. So that was my other question.
Okay.
Is how do you judge how much pressure to apply? Because you're going to influence the vibration of this object.
Oh, you know what we didn't use, and yours is still in the condition to do it. We had this pressure meter we set up. Do you want to try to get pressure?
Yeah, let's take a look. We can always diagnose the real data later. I don't think we have the calibration data handy.
Nope. So this is the pressure meter. Where are we here? From the protogasm, right?
Yeah, Melissa, do you want to give us a...
Pull too hard.
The close-up cam?
The close-up cam, yeah.
We're in it.
So, this is a... It will eventually focus. This is a little pressure meter. It is... what is this? It's not absolute, it's gauge pressure, right?
Because
it's to atmosphere. So the atmosphere port is on the bottom, and the pressure port's on the front here. But we're going to just hold the atmosphere port, and we can get some sort of reading on the Rigel. Right?
Yeah, the issue there being you can't measure vacuum normally on this gauge.
I might just hold it.
Okay. Yeah, so we have this set up to the scope. So this will be a dimensionless number for now. But we can reverse correlate this back to a real reading later, and we'll publish a little bit. So one of the plans is also publish all the technical data from these teardowns on the Open Arousal site, so you can go see how much power, how much current, how much suction, in like numerical form, for those that are interested. My engineering side, I think this should come with a data sheet that shows you the suction, the frequency, speed values. This is crazy, right? I mean, someone designed this thing, they know exactly how it works.
Do they?
Elims also mentioned to try using it on the ABS and not the silicone.
The vibrometer? I see, because it's going to damp.
So I think, like, we're going to... So actually, one interesting thing is it does load down. And you see how it goes into this... we've got this kind of square wave where it's, like, clipping because it doesn't have enough force. If I push too hard on it, I can definitely hear the motor... stall. I don't know if we can get that or on mic. You can hear it stalling.
So it can't actually generate full suction.
Yeah, I guess it can't pull.
Okay.
That
not
part of a vacuum.
Not full vacuum, but some part of a vacuum.
You're not going to use this for decasting silicone.
So
Why don't you just hit pause and we'll take a look at some. There we go. So what's the speed on that? Oh, it's saying like 24 hertz?
Yeah, this says 34 hertz. And looks like up to about
100 how this is calibrated, right? For the output?
Yeah, exactly. So I don't think we'll have to come up with a real number.
We won't do it. We'll post it.
Yeah, well, no point. But,
I mean, I like watching people read data sheets and try to figure the shit out, but...
We can leave that for the end.
Yeah, for...
If you want to stick around at the end, we will calibrate this back to a real reading.
For the true fans, right?
Yeah.
For
the true fans. No judgment.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
you
sorry.
Don't stick around for the data sheet reading. You're not a true fan.
I really wish we had a fireplace we could sit next to and just read data sheets like a novel.
Oh, boy.
Can we get the overhead cam again? So, there is a wild difference in the positioning mechanism. This purple one is actually... you know what? It might be the same on the inside, but it has this extra layer of protection. This popped out as I was taking it apart aggressively. But this is... I was trying to win, yes. This is very common on, like, microphones, gooseneck microphones and stuff like that. I don't know what the name of this mechanism is. Do you?
Yeah, actually, I don't know the technical term for
this. Spiral thingy,
coil
positional
spring,
thingy.
Yeah.
It feels like maybe there's one inside of here as well, but just has this extra...
I think the nice ones use just, like, a galvanized steel core or something, right? Like a mild steel wire. Because
right.
This has a lot of return... Right, like it always wants to spring back, whereas like a nice thick galvanized wire or like a copper wire or something really holds its position much nicer. I know that's what's in like the Lovin stores.
Okay. We'll just throw all the screws and stuff in there and mix it all together. Cool. Is that a pre-puffed battery or is that just?
Zoom it out.
Oh, sorry. You gotta move in.
Okay, is that fully zoomed out?
I think so. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. I'll lean in.
So, yeah, not much odd there. Basically, like we were saying, there's an off-center crank on the motor, and it moves a little diaphragm.
Is looking remarkably similar.
Battery's bigger, or well, different format. This is 350 milliamps hours. Milliamp hours.
Puffy lipo is bad news.
Yeah,
well, it depends what your goals are, but
it feels solid.
Yeah,
I think just
okay.
The way it's built.
It did get jammed a bit on the end, obviously, but
yeah.
I have here a 300 milliamp hour.
In, like, so here, why don't we hold them up next to each other, like, wildly different packages?
Yeah, it's always interesting, the milliamp hour versus form factor is never quite what I expect it to be. You gain a lot with thickness. Actually, yeah, from a battery perspective, that's interesting. Probably a current limiting trade-off.
I wonder if there is, yeah, because
you have less surface area here.
Look at the size of that motor versus this one here.
Yeah.
Maybe we zoom in for this a little bit. Just got to make sure we stay, you know, in frame kind of thing.
Yeah, I definitely have an extra stack length in there kind of thing.
Oh, and that's the charge port there on yours. I think the charge port on mine was all the way at the... Doesn't charge? I don't know.
This is a one-time use. Yeah, someone who tore apart those one-time use suction toys.
No, honestly, this might be a one-time use.
No, I'm sure there's a...
No, there's seriously no charge.
It's this.
Where? right there.
I don't think we right. can see that.
Oh, sorry. It was, I cut right through it. That's why.
Okay.
Yeah. It's, it is very it's right where my thumb is. Yeah.
I'm sorry. I can't remember. Yeah, but someone yeah, tore down those one-time use stories.
Is it like a disposable satisfier?
Yes. Yes.
Anna Sophia mentioned that earlier.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, mine actually has a very, well, that's kind of cool.
Oh, a ball bearing?
A very tiny bearing. Let's see if it's possible to get that on camera, but, oh, it's not going to focus. That's the,
how about,
close up
cam?
Get in there!
Feels like we just went, like, first person or something. So, the end of this motor actually has a small bearing on it, and let's see if it will, yeah, so it actually has a tiny little bearing on that, whereas this guy is,
plastic crank. Oh, no, there's a plastic, bushing.
Just a bushing.
Okay. Just a bushing.
I am actually not a fan of bushings,
And your $20 tool, so you want, yeah.
Very, very interesting that they would put that. Yeah, I wonder how much impact that has on the performance, like how much power is lost in that bushing versus this bearing, because that's relatively, still a cheap part, but...
It's another part.
It's another part, and when you're making toys like this, you're trying to save every half cent that you can.
Mr. Sauna Barrel thinks that's a very bad place for the charging port.
Yeah, it's not great.
Right at the head of the toy?
Yeah.
I generally agree.
Again, don't want to badmouth. Again, other people have made other decisions, but this is clearly a cost form factor thing.
Yeah,
right?
It keeps it very close to the circuit board, which is usually what people are looking for, right? You're trying to keep the circuit board as small as possible, the wiring, and even just the assembly, right? When you think about having to have an assembly where you're running long wires down a shaft, and you really want to try and limit that from a quality standpoint, it's easy to make mistakes or get wires pinched. So the closer all the electronics are, it's just more likely that thing's going to show up working.
I will say the charge port seems to be a little more protected on the purple toy over the pink one. The pink one, there's no... I mean, unless I really cut into it. I mean, there's a little bit of an inside feature.
Yeah, it's hard to tell.
But I remember when we were on the phone talking about this before we tore it down, there's like this little flap. There is like a ceiling flap.
Yeah.
Which I don't think was just a bad punch. I think that looks intentional, but...
Yeah, I think it's... Well, I think it's a sealed piece, and then they poke a small hole, and so the idea being the silicone expands around that little... hole that they punched.
Yeah.
I enjoy the user manual for this one. It has this great flamingo
scene. A flamingo!
Can we...
Oh, wow. Yeah,
we're gonna see.
That's beautiful.
I hope that's,
Is that some cacti?
Pink cacti?
Pink cacti, ice cubes, and flamingo. Oh, and a feather.
Branding.
Yeah.
Branding is important, everyone.
Yeah. It's just it's just building a lifestyle brand around good times is what that is.
Those are the three things that make me think of good times.
The vibrator here is a pretty standard counterweight here, eccentric weight. Oh, you've got some dampening in there, and this one is solidly mounted into the plastic. I think I'm on.
And also a single piece housing, yeah.
Yeah. It was there was a cap for the weight to stop that, right?
Yeah. But clearly a lot more engineering, structural rigidity, and I'm going to use the word robustness put into some of this.
Yeah, and this was just glued together, came across the part, and screwed. Not that you're going to service one of these, but...
as the person tearing the door apart, I really appreciate... Thank you for using screws.
Yeah.
That's my own personal...
Mr. Sauna Barrel says, yep, but it's on the wet side. Why not just the back side instead?
The backside, it's insertable, right?
Yeah, so the trick is it's not a great, this is probably, maybe the better, I guess you have to put it here. That's an interesting point, because they intended the other side to be insertable, so it would.
As far as that goes, this is more slender, right? So. Yeah.
If slender is good.
I was going to say, I don't want to assume anybody.
That's funny.
Yeah. It's the same problem we're running into with the Awesome, right? For ports, and some people, or everybody has their own preference.
Yeah.
Or length of stroke?
Yep.
Yeah, well, length of stroke is another one.
Yeah. Just cheap enamel wires here. Do you have insulation on your wires?
I have actual wires.
Pennies. Pennies more!
Yeah. this enameled magnet wire is very popular, it seems, in sex toys. For running power to motors, this very fine wire with no jacket on it. James, you're more on the electrical side than I am. Any comment on?
I don't know. I see it everywhere. It's how you put together a transformer, but seeing the wire, I just don't trust it.
Yeah. And you can't inspect to see if there's insulation.
And when I think enamel, I think much more. It's just a mental block. Like, yeah. I mean, clearly it works just fine,
obviously,
right?
Yeah.
But when I think enamel, I think hard and something that could brittle, right?
With age, yeah.
Yeah.
That is true. It's certainly easy to nick a bit of insulation off of that. It's, you know, extremely thin.
Yeah. Did you find anything that surprised you?
I am going to say the bearing on this output was the most surprise of the day.
Right.
Bearing on this output, which I really think is a ball bearing. It's not just a metal bushing.
You gonna make a fidget toy out of it?
It spins quite a while. I don't know if you can hear that on camera, but it really moves. So that was kind of the surprise. Then actually this motor format is a bit unusual. You normally see motors that are a little stubbier than this. So that was, I don't know, I'm not quite ready to call it interesting, but that was the surprise for me, I think.
Think for something, two things that are same price, wildly different approaches to how they put it together.
Yeah,
right?
So this is something we ran into last Teardown.
Yeah.
Was we took apart these two pinpoint vibrators. So there were, you know, sort of like a pen style vibrator where the vibrating tip was at the end of some long arm. And so I was curious to see, did anything intelligent happen in here? Is the vibrator at the tip? Is it at the base and it's like a tuned rod? You can't see me, I don't. Where is the vibrator? How effective is it? And so we bought two toys that were within $5 of each other.
In fact, the less expensive one was the more mechanically complex one, right?
So one looked sort of, had like gold trim and was beautiful. And it had like a phone vibrator motor in it, basically.
Yeah.
Like a microscopic one just jammed into the plastic.
Into a piece of plastic on the end.
Yeah, like that was it. And the other one actually had real mechanical thought into it. They'd reversed the motor and it was having this like oscillating lever arm effect. And so actually it was quite nice. And so just no way to know that as a consumer looking at a device, right? So that maybe, yeah, very interesting how much effort you put into developing a device and the design approaches you take.
Maybe we see how much this can take if it blows up.
Sure, yeah.
With a variable power supply.
What's on our list of things to do today? We also want to run through the Vaculock test.
Yeah. We also have to look at the vacuum.
The inflatable.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to check the time. It's 2:30.
Okay. Do you want to just move on to the next toy? In chat, do we want to blow something up or do we want to just move on to taking a look at the next thing?
Please place your votes now.
Yeah, let us know. We're happy to do whatever. That's the foam piece?
That's the foam piece that was around the...
Wow.
So instead of this molded...
Yeah, wow.
Significantly cheaper.
Yeah. I would love to, know the bomb cost of these two.
And when you look at it from the outside, I don't think there was... Like, this doesn't show through.
No.
As in, like, it doesn't... Like, if you had them in your hands, I don't think they felt particularly different.
Yeah, I agree.
We have two votes for bloated up.
Okay. So that's what we're going to do.
Forced our hand.
Yeah. We didn't want to do this.
Can you guys just pull the table slightly that way?
Back towards us?
Yeah.
Yep. Is that to get more of this on camera?
Because you keep working back here.
Wait, then should we push the table that way?
No. Now we can see what you're doing, I think.
Perfect.
So, do we have a close-up cam in the corner to show the voltages? And do we have another one where they... Front camera large. Yeah, I know. We can just work with it right in front.
Yeah, or alternatively, we could pop that thing up so the overhead cam could see it.
Oh, pop this up.
Yeah.
I don't know if I have enough.
Something like that. Rest it on the gauge.
Oh, yeah, there we go. There's a connection. Okay, so it is already current limiting because I have it set to 0.1 amp. See if we
can
take it.
Watch your hand.
Zoom out, or it's no. I think this is. How about this? If I hold it right where I'm supposed to hold it, it seems like it's going well significantly more than
yeah.
Let's see if we can find the voltage. It was probably probably running
three volts if
something like that, and not pulling more than 0.1 amp, 0.3 of a watt. Just give it. We should take the amperage.
Just pull the current limit off. And then
yeah.
See. Oh, does anyone? How much power do you think we can get into this motor?
How much before my hand gets burnt? Any guesses?
James, where's the first aid kit?
In the drawer marked with the. Okay. Let's go.
Oh, wow. Something is. Is it still engaging the pump?
It is. It's not doing anything. Oh, no, actually,
I think
it is.
We have something like an instrument here.
Oh! It broke the mechanical linkage just as it was smoking.
Wow.
So the mechanical linkage completely broke.
I see, because it's a clamp mechanism. I see. So that diaphragm was actually clamped.
This plate here was holding the diaphragm down. I don't think the diaphragm ruptured. No. Could be put back together, but there was definitely a piece of plastic that came off here.
What was it at?
0.38?
You'll have to watch the replay for that. I got distracted by the smoke and the safety squint. Do you protect my eyes?
Not happy yet. Ow! Oh, that's it. Yeah, it's not happy at 23 volts, but it's still going. Smoke's gone.
Got a nice smell to it.
Yeah. Wish there was more fire.
Oh, yeah. Could not burn. Could not. No fire.
We clearly need to get 10 amps through it.
Fire test one.
Yeah. So, somebody posted this to the Discord, and I bought it within about 5 seconds of seeing it. It is an inflating plug. One of the things that caught my eye about testing it here on the bench was it seems to have at least a pressure switch in it, because it will, we can see it inflating. It will eventually stop. And not even try to pump anymore. It's not like it bogs down. Mm-hmm. On these sucker toys, they were bogging down when they got to too much pressure.
Yeah, not enough torque on the motor to keep going.
Yeah, so right now the motor's cut off completely, and it won't inflate. The other thing that was interesting is when you hit the release, it releases fully. It doesn't just like drop the pressure a little bit. It's always full release. So, in this toy, I guess we're going to see a pressure switch. What else are we going to see?
Yeah, some sort of tiny pump, a pressure switch. Yeah, I'm really curious. They must be very small.
We've got the butt plug whisperer.
what are you doing?
Start to hear. So, what else?
really hoping you would have played it in your ear.
So what I was listening for was, could you hear an, like, when it a stopped, click? Is there a click, right? Which might indicate a pressure, like a one set pressure switch. Or no click, maybe it's a solid state pressure sensor. What I actually heard was a 2 second hiss. So I heard air, as it is reaching max inflation, you hear some air leaking. After about 2 seconds of that, then the motor turns off.
Hmm.
So
there's maybe like there's overpressure or something?
Some more novel mechanism.
If you clench down on it with your hand, does it let more air out?
No. There's definitely no like safety. No. So it's I'm not sure. I'm honestly not sure.
I hope we're gonna be surprised.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Some notes on this, I guess it is labeled in and out. For some reason. Melissa, can we have the overhead? So out is down here at the bottom and in is here forward. I don't know why that is relevant, but I do appreciate labeling.
The air inlet and outlet?
Yeah.
I guess,
is there anything in the manual there, yeah, Melissa, that says, like...
I don't think you guys gave me that one.
Oh. I don't know if we have it. Got it?
Where's the box?
Box is down. Oh, here it is.
Is it this?
Yeah.
Let me take a look. This is a Bomex.
Hold it down.
Stand on your head. Are you happy with this?
Are you happy?
Don't use it while charging. None of these are funny yet. Hold on.
Actually, that's funny. You can barely have the charger hold on when it's sitting on the desk.
Has a bit of a phaser vibe to it. Like a hairdryer.
It says don't block the in-out air hole, or it might not be able to inflate or deflate. Don't use this underwater.
Okay. Should we put it in a glass of water to see if it sucks in all the water?
We should run it with a fluid, maybe.
Yeah.
Do you think it will run with the fluid, everyone in the chat? Fluid, no fluid? I can't turn the vibe.
It says it's waterproof, but not, you can't do water immersion.
Hmm.
It says don't use alcohol or acetone on it.
Oh, that's the other thing. When you turn it off, it automatically deflates.
Yeah.
Oh, it has some nice preparation tips.
So it clearly has some sort of tiny valve. And this is really interesting, actually. We talked quite a bit about micro fluid electronics. How do you control fluid in very small spaces? And I know a number of companies put research into like air pressure toys, right? And one of the challenges is, one, getting small pumps, and two is, how do you switch the air pressure around valves, like tiny little valves, to redirect it.
I wish we had Kyle in chat, because he knows quite a bit about...
Kyle is the valve man.
Valve man!
James, while you're doing that, I might see what I can do with this motor. I'm gonna...
Okay, yeah.
What else does it say here?
What is this?
It says to enjoy anal play, it is important to prepare beforehand.
Voltage, and then you press this to get through digit.
How do I actually make it do it?
That's the same. We believe our product will take your sex life to the next level. We sincerely invite you to come in and give it a try. What you find here may surprise you.
There we go.
Oh, Mr. Sauna Barrel wants us to test it and says we should get a bucket of water.
Yes,
James, bucket of water on hand?
Hope I didn't take apart too much.
Oh, this makes these make very lovely sounds, actually.
Can we make it suck water?
Yes, we will. That thing really... Whoa, yeah. My goodness. You have to get a little closer. That's, these things really just need more voltage.
More
voltage.
This
is quite a sensation. Oh. My goodness.
A little bit above the ground.
Oh, you gotta do it in the...
Oh.
translates on camera, but
can we get the close-up cam in there?
Yeah, this is
okay. Sorry?
Can you send it with an amp, Alex?
The limit. Sorry, Jane.
It's okay.
Did we get to an amp? Anyone in the chat? I wasn't paying.
Yeah.
Well, that happened very quickly. interestingly, the motor is still intact. Everything is intact. The bearing just popped out.
Same failure mode as the other one.
Yeah, but it's still like you can just pop it back in. It just popped out of the sleeve. So if there was like a more robust mechanism. I mean,
capture it.
Yeah, the motor is getting a little bit warm now for sure, but wow.
Water cooler.
Cool it down.
That was like a water jet, yeah. Oh my goodness, wow.
Okay, raw water jet.
That is the new most surprising part of the day is that people should be putting 2-cell lipos in these, at least for temporary higher power. Or we should start putting brushless motors in these and like really ramp this thing up.
Brushless outrunners?
What else?
Yeah. What other kind of motor is that?
Yeah, no, but that was, wow. That looked like it would have done some work.
You know what? Why don't we bring back the cam from safety here and for the inflatable water test.
Anna Sophia is living for the sounds. We should have an ASMR mic.
Yeah. We should have a close-up camera and a close-up mic.
Yeah.
We get for that. Because I love these sounds. They're actually so interesting.
Aren't they?
It's funny because a few times I wasn't sure if I should be turning the microphones down. It's getting a bit loud.
I don't know if we have... Oh, you know what? We might not have compression on here, so we might not be clipping. So sorry for our headphone users. I do apologize. can we get the close-up cam for this? Something like that. And that's more or less in front. Okay. Let's see if it does.
Seems totally fine.
Seems like it's having...
Is there...
Struggle?
I'm not sure if there's... There must be water in there, right?
Both the in and the merged.
Yeah. Well, we'll know when you let it out.
Yeah.
This is all...
Oh, yeah, there's water in there.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. This is going to be the good part.
Do we want... A close-up cam or a front view?
Yeah, I think this is good.
Ah.
Oh! What? How did it...
So where is the air coming from?
It says it came in here.
All right, submerge the whole thing, James.
Just go for it.
They're waiting for you to get shocked.
Thanks.
Just got a -1 point from you for that.
Oh, it's struggling now. Now it's heavy. I can feel it like it's trying to pump.
Yeah.
And it's not.
There clearly must have been some air in there that it was,
Oh, and I also got it in the body of the thing. Let's see what happens when you... Oh, it is totally not happy. It's...
It just peed on James.
I don't know if that got...
I don't know if that got translated.
There's the perfect tiny screen. Yeah. That squirted all over James.
Oh my god.
Oh boy. That Tori squirted on you.
Yeah.
I'm so glad I was looking at you for that.
Yeah. Wow. Okay.
Did
anyone see that? Let me know.
Yeah. That's hilarious. Yeah, this would be another interesting one to give a little bit more power and then thank you. A little bit more power and then maybe we can run that water again, but with more juice.
It would be cool if it had a fixed fluid cavity, like so a cavity, so that and then it just moved the fluid back and forth, right?
Yeah.
But it would make it a lot more messy.
You just need two. It needs to be like a double penetrating mechanism, and then it could like move the fluid from one to the other.
Now you're coming up with a new idea for a toy.
Oh, should I give them chat? Access to Awesome in the background?
Yeah.
How do I do? Do I just copy this link?
And
just that number.
Huh? Both, I guess. So you have to give them the link and the number.
What's the number?
Well, it's right there.
Yeah, awesome 2222.
Yeah, all caps.
Yes.
The case sensitive, everything.
Sorry, I'm cutting. Not on the right camera. So it's not as wet inside as I thought it might be. Oh, there's an air filter. It's filtered air for your plug.
As you would expect.
Yeah, I mean, well, let's see.
Oh, there's still some stuff in there, yeah.
Okay. There's definitely water in there. I'm gonna aim that at you. Yeah. Uh-oh, now I turned on the vibrator, so this is going to take forever to shut off. Okay, so that...
It's sealed around that part.
Yeah.
This is one thing I've always been curious about, is how...
Well,
hello? Hello, friends. What was I curious about? Oh, how inflatable silicone is. Like, how well it distributes that in comparison to latex or something like that. Right? Like, silicone has quite an elongation failure value. It's like 800% or something.
Okay.
I'll
take your word for that.
It depends on the silicone. That's the last silicone I poured was something like 800% on the data sheet. So it will stretch 800% of its original length before it fails. But I'm curious to know what that is comparison to latex. And like, if you made a silicone balloon, like how would its properties compare with a latex balloon? Seems like latex has much more sort of tensile strength, but silicone comes in so many flavors.
Right.
Like, why are we not making silicone balloons?
Price?
Probably.
I will say on this, now this is not a complaint, it's just, I find it interesting, you can see like the mold is not a very good, actually I wonder if it's textured, not very good, there's a lot of tooling marks on it, but it might actually be textured for adhesion, yeah.
Yeah, or at the very least, yeah, it doesn't hurt it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, right? Yeah.
Yeah. We're thinking maybe we'll make the Awesome a permanent part of the Twitch stream, and hopefully, maybe I don't want to overcommit, but we'll just have...
Oh.
The controls built into the chat.
Please don't do Max Stroke.
Or if you want to see Max Stroke, then
yeah, you can see it breaking. I mean, it's fine.
If you love loud sounds.
Yeah.
But it built into the chat. So some interactive element where you can control the Awesome, and maybe we can put like different fun end effectors on it for each episode. Oh wow.
It's
beautiful.
Is that okay? Oh, you were just trying to show the Awesome?
Yeah. I've been going back and forth.
Yeah.
Like everyone to enjoy all the views.
Great. What are you trying here? A little more light?
Yeah,
it's a little dark. Okay. So, it is jam-packed with stuff going on in here. So, there's the pump. There's the ejection. Oh, so that air coming in is just... in general.
Okay.
So that's why he was able to pull
it
from the
back. Yeah, I just merge it completely.
Yeah. So where does the air come in? I think we can pull this apart.
I have to admit, I'm a bit wet everywhere. I didn't anticipate this stream getting
so wet. Stream on screen, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, again, a different format battery.
Foam on everything, eh?
Yeah.
That's interesting. I guess really conscious of the vibrations.
I think this box here is going to be the magic.
It looks like it.
So it looks like we have a motor driving a pump, and then the magic switch box.
I'm curious a little bit what kind of pump that is.
Did the lipo get wet?
The lipo, yeah.
Everything. Everything
here,
is definitely.
Everything
wet.
Is wet.
You can dig into there if you want, while I dig into here. They're both on.
More hands.
Yeah.
Yikes.
Everything's wet and slippery, so if I, you know, cut my hand.
Sharper tools.
Yeah.
answer is something like, how fast can 10 people tear down one toy?
Now, this is looking a lot like a solenoid to
me. Yeah, that is just a solenoid. Damn. Huh. Okay.
But also, there's no monitoring.
I don't see anything.
Oh, what's this? No, that's vibrator. Vibrator? Maybe?
This is very interesting. Yeah, I don't see... That's charging. Battery. Feeding the solenoid.
So I wonder if it's just time.
Like run time.
Run
the
time
motor,
on that button.
No,
yeah.
Before you release it, which is also another digital input. That's interesting.
So, you know what we can do?
Just run it manually?
Just run the fucker.
And then we'll see.
Yeah.
Okay, I won't take this pump apart just yet.
Can we get this to explode? Do we want to bypass this? Is this a one-way? This is a one-way valve, right? In theory?
It must be, yeah.
Now, whether or not we have to engage it.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Find out. We should just be able to give power to those terminals. We'll give it 2 volt. Oh, you want to use... Okay.
I'm just going to throw it on camera.
You want to throw it in this set right here? You can come all the way down here. Cool. So if you hook up those two from here. I've already got it set to, oh, okay. Either way. I was thinking 2 volts. Let's not give it a full chooch at the beginning.
Is that pumping?
Yeah, okay. Let's give it a little bit more. Keep going. Yeah, okay. It's going. That scene on... It's stalling, but I think you can keep...
Interesting. And so that... Do you want to try activating that solenoid?
Sure.
Which...
I can totally do that with things.
But yeah, obviously it seems there's no actual limit on the motor assembly for pumping this thing. It will just continue pumping forever. I don't want to destroy it just yet. Okay.
Yeah. So
just a release.
Sorry. We gotta get that.
Don't pop it.
So it's just a solenoid.
To open the valve and release the pressure. And so it seems like the logic is in the IC how long it's pumped up for. So it's not a pressure thing.
So we were wrong.
Yeah.
You wanna give a safety logic? Well, I think what maybe we do is we stand back and just let it go.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll just...
We'll wear our sunglasses at night and stand back and just let it go.
Put your glasses on.
What will fail first?
I think the pump will give up before it has anywhere near a chance.
Yeah, I think the pump will just stop being efficient and it will just...
Yeah, although it looks a little saggy. That's the whole sandbag. I thought the bar in the middle of the sandbag was really going to help with
stiffness, but what ends up happening is you end up with two bags of sand on either side of a bar, so it doesn't, like, yeah.
Just gonna check. Oh, that's getting quite compressed. Motor's a bit warmer, running it pretty hot, but that's okay.
Oh yeah, it is. I really have no idea. I've never seen a silicone bubble pop before.
Should we stand on the other side of a wall or something?
There is. Something tells me this little motor can't put out that much pressure, but I would be curious to know how much pressure this is also.
Nothing calibrated nearby.
Yeah. No. Maybe another test we'll do is just see just with that pumpkin input. At some point, this may get boring. Are we actually going to let this go all the way? I don't know how long we should let this go from the viewers. You can tell us. Let us know when this gets. We're just watching, like.
Apparently, we should have safety glasses and earplugs.
Earplugs is actually not a bad idea. Yeah,
interesting.
As the producer of the show, I supplied them both with safety glasses.
Ish. Oh, there we go. Safety shield.
Oh my god, it's huge.
It is continuing to grow.
I'm just trying to imagine doing this in someone's butt.
There you go.
Yeah. In someone's butt. Yeah, so I guess this is why the safety exists.
Yeah.
So that you can't inflate it too much.
Oh my gosh. I don't know if the container is big enough to contain it.
Yeah. This is quite large. Well, if anyone has large insertion desires, you could mod this toy
pretty easily
to do that for you.
Yeah.
Keshem has arrived in our Twitch chat.
Oh, hello.
Hello.
I'm scared. I can't tell if it's still growing or not. It's.
Is it dead?
I don't know. I'm not even sure how we will know. Do we want to, like, pop it with a pin?
Yeah! Yeah, I'm disappointed that that's it.
That's it? Guys, should we talk about our prize for today?
Yeah.
We actually have a prize for one of our viewers of the stream.
How large do we think that is? Safety shield has now become more dangerous than it is.
Right. Well, I'm putting safety yellow on the pin I'm going to use.
Okay.
I don't know what it is about my shop in the shivs.
Oh my goodness.
Oh my god.
So here we go.
Is that a needle?
Yeah, it's a sewing knife.
It's still growing.
It's sewing, yeah.
But are we ready, chat? Do we want to call it a day? We'll give it a poke.
Do you want us to pop it? Let me know. Vote. Pop it or leave it.
More power?
More power?
Did you say more power?
Pop it.
Pop it.
Wow.
Is I the only one actually wearing the earplugs?
Oh, I forgot. Yeah. No, everyone on chat.
We all wore them.
I wore them around my neck like a cool kid.
Thank you for the safety glasses.
Wow. All
right.
Oh, yeah.
Whew. So that was interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys caught this, but I have a prize to give out to one of our viewers today.
Okay.
So, yeah, I mean, it's... So it ripped. Okay, it just opened up. There is a piece somewhere.
Nice. A lot of the crappy ones have just hard plastic here.
Yeah.
So then it's, like, very, very rigid. At least this is a little soft when in its, like, deflated state. Oh, that was fun, guys. I enjoyed that.
I have to admit that got much larger than I expected.
I expected it to go poof before that.
Yeah, that was late. So, silicone balloons.
Yeah.
Maybe a thing.
Oh, it let a nice spray of water out over the the electrical.
This is all low voltage, guys, don't worry.
Yeah.
M says, considering it was $35 Canadian, pretty impressive, actually.
Not bad, right? Yeah, that got a fair size.
Kiwi says, impressive that the pump is still able to keep pushing.
Yeah.
Does anyone know what PSI?
That's what we were talking about. It would have been nice. I think we should buy one more of these.
A couple more.
Another.
Yeah.
And let's tee off pressure.
Yeah.
And then run this thing. Because one thing I did notice is at 3 volts, it kind of stalled on the size. Pump it up more and more voltage. We start getting more pressure and then more volume.
Oh, shit. We could have put a PSI from over here.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, it'll be a feature. There'll be a follow-up for this one. I think, this one will make an appearance in another episode. Or at least, we'll do an extra video or something.
Yeah.
On seeing what the real limitation of this balloon motor combination is. See how large we can get it with just the motor, and then with infinite PSI, kind of take the Mythbusters approach. Like, what will it really
just
take?
Just how bad we can do this?
Yeah. So,
Do we know maybe do a hydrostat.
The size of the valve.
So, what size do you want? Because we can give you the size, but it's.
You have a ruler handy? We can have it. You know, we should have a ruler on this desk.
There is one right there, and there's also calipers if you want.
Keep that in your chair.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, we're on centimeters.
This doesn't camera very well, but
No. It's 1.5 centimeters long
for the body.
The valve is, what do you say, that's 1 millimeter port on it?
Yeah, the actual ID?
Yeah.
About a millimeter, a millimeter and a bit.
Mr. Sonnenbarrel wants you to rebuild one for cum tube usage.
Ah, you know.
Oh, so pump here.
Hey, why don't we just pump some water with this? Where's the intake to this pump?
I think it's all the way around here. I bet you it's... I don't want to bet. I was going to say, it might be like with those ones. This is the problem. I was saying it in, what was that toy? The stroker. One of those oscillating air valve things, right?
I think that's a seal.
Well, where do you think the air comes in? The backside?
I don't think any air comes in. I'm just kidding.
I can't see what
through the motor. Cooling through
it
the
might
motor.
Be through the motor, though.
Yeah. Oh, you gotta come.
Yeah, thanks. It might be through the motor.
And if you
have I
block it? No.
It's very hard to tell. There's not much flow happening.
Maybe we can turn down the awesome, and then we can maybe hear it. Yeah, there's not a lot.
It seems to push air in both polarities, though. And maybe I don't know what type of pump this is. Okay, I'll stop fiddling with this, but we should play with this. Do you have that water hand? Ah, we don't need to do this. I don't know. Does everyone still want to think about pumps? But
can you get water?
I never know how interesting this is to the audience watching. If they're just as gripped as I am about how this pump works, or if this is totally boring. So feel free to be like, this is totally boring. Just let it go. I won't be offended at all.
In fact, turn the awesome up if you want.
Yeah, maybe that will be the crowd metric. Yep. It just pulled it in through the motor.
Can we get close up cam?
Oh shit. Oh my God. Sorry, I'm losing focus.
So it pulls in the air from the back of the motor.
Yeah. So you actually have to submerge the interface where the motor meets the pump.
I think Mr. Sonnenbarrel is as intuitive as you are.
Okay, excellent. So yeah, there you go. If you could stick that in a cum tube, and that would do this.
If you want this, then it will
work
for you. Well,
I mean...
Oh, yeah.
That, until you do. Oh.
Wow, Jaden.
Wow, look at the extra flow.
Wow.
That's 11
Very
volts.
Impressive.
Let's go up to... and it doesn't go... It just never gets any more flow.
But maybe more pressure?
Maybe, no. Oh! Yeah, no, I'm definitely getting more water on me.
So I don't think the flow really changes, but it definitely starts generating... Oh, yeah, that's a good amount of pressure. I don't know if that's... Oh, sorry.
Directed right at the camera and me. This, I don't know if you can see the carnage.
Things are a touch wet.
Yeah.
But yeah, actually, now that you see the water in there, you can sort of see in the shadow of the pump, the flow.
We have the overhead again?
It's pretty hard to show on the camera, but we'll do some close-up of that later. Neat little pump.
Yeah.
That's a nice little device. We need a streaming towel, I
just thinking that.
Maybe we should take a couple of minutes to clean up the table, reset for vacuolock tests.
Vacuolock?
Yeah.
Mr. Sonnet Barrel feels ashamed.
Why? What do you feel ashamed of?
It's
amazing.
I thought that was great.
Yeah.
I was very impressed by the pressure output of this little pump. That was really cool. I'm going to take this apart while James works.
Okay.
Is this like a gear mesh pump, or what is happening inside of this thing? And yeah, let's buy some more of these.
I'm gonna take all of these lipos, put them in a safe.
Someone says that you should pump the cum into the plug and use the valve to release.
Uh-huh.
Ah.
Whoa. I can't say I've seen this before. This is very cool. Wow. Melissa, could you throw the close-up cam? So this is what's on the inside of this. So you can see there's an eccentric shaft on the motor output. And this little guy here, this shaft moves on that eccentric and makes this toggling motion like that, which pumps these two diaphragms. I know this is sort of like black on black, and it's a little hard to get good contrast to see what's happening there, but there are these little plungers here that move back and forth. And actually, yeah, if I can pull that, I can't pull the whole mechanism out, but these bits here are actually flaps that look like one-way valves.
Oh, wow.
And so these plungers sort of change the volume, and then when there's negative pressure, these one-way valves operate. This is... I have not seen a pump like this before. Has anyone seen this pumping mechanism?
I think that's pretty similar to what Big Clive took apart for fish air pumps.
Okay. Yeah, maybe this is very standard for miniature pumps. I just haven't really taken apart miniature pumps before. Wow, that's very cool. If anyone knows the name of this pump, I'm interested. But very simple, very cheap design.
Membrane pump?
Membrane pump. That sounds good to me. I don't know if we're naming it that or if that's the real name, but I believe you. That sounds like that's what I would call this. I think that's a good choice.
Did I have a question mark at the end?
Oh, whoa. Okay, this is why it works.
And there's races.
Yeah, so there's actually little channels in here.
And does that look like there's another set of valves? Because you need two valves for a pump, right?
Yeah, so... Yeah, those are one-way valves, as tested by putting it in my mouth.
Calibrated.
Calibrating.
Wow, with these little channels that route the air back to the other one-way valves. Very cool.
Bad things happened.
Very cool. And I guess you could have 1, 2, 3, 4, or 10 of these little membranes to optimize the space versus flow and power output.
So that's going to be more displacement, so more flow, probably? Is that how that works?
Yeah, less pressure. But it is interesting that the flow really didn't increase with speed.
Yeah, because you would think more times, more revolutions.
Maybe
would be
the
more
these tiny orifices that the water has to travel through is really limiting it. So it ends up just compressing it, but not moving much water. Interesting.
Cool.
Wow. Okay, what a great day this has been.
Now we bring out...
Oh, I hope these notes weren't important.
Do we want new space for notes, or do we want...
That's okay.
Okay. I guess overhead cam, please. Quizmaster.
Guys, we have viewers from Germany and Sweden in here.
Ah. Hello! Welcome!
Welcome.
I mean, they've been here the whole time.
Well, thanks for staying.
Thank you. Yeah. Thanks for not running away.
It's just when we said the what did I call it? Membrane pump?
Membrane pump?
Yeah, they're like, I don't know what the word is for English.
Oh.
So I'm like, where are you tuning in?
Gotcha.
Yeah, thanks for sharing. We should ask where everyone's tuning in from more often.
Yeah.
It's very satisfying. That's like, I mean, okay, everyone's been on the internet for a while, but I think the internet is kind of a new medium, at least like this. Not the internet is new to us, but we haven't been streaming like this in this sort of like super real-time interactive way. So it's really nice to get... most of the time, I think when I'm talking about this, it's always kind of in a local setting. So it's really cool to have this super global platform. So this is a setup. James, do you want me to introduce this while you're...
Yeah.
Getting set up, or would you rather get
it? I mean, yeah, I'm here,
together?
So but go ahead and introduce it. You know what's going on.
No, I actually don't. I was just going to make something up.
Oh, okay.
But this is purple, and...
What?
It has a...
Okay, so this
is... What the hell is that?
This is a fisting toy, but it is the cheapest Vacu-Lock compatible... Oh, sorry, Doc Johnson actual Vacu-Lock, because we wanted to make sure the shape is correct.
Can you zoom in at all? Or...
Sorry?
Can we zoom in at all? Because you can't zoom in.
Sorry.
Oh, thank you.
There we go. Now you can see the hand properly?
Yeah.
Okay. So we've got a official Vacu-Lock. Now it's in a more flexible plastic, but it's on the end of an air cylinder. And the idea here is that we're going to apply air on the rod end and try to push it out and use the amount of PSI we have to apply to try to figure out how much force it is to pull out. This is the official Vacu-Lock. Then we also have the double-double. We have a Vacu-Lock with a hole in the middle, a vent tube, so that it's actually not a vacuum lock, it's just a shape. And then we have a 3D printed equivalent Vacu-Lock. So the idea there is that we get a force with the official one in the official toy, then we get a 3D printed one in the official toy, and then we see if there's any decrease with a vented one, and then we will show how the force compares to the double-double. Right?
Yeah,
makes sense?
Good.
And I think actually at the end of that, I'm just going to take a bunch of tape and put it on the end of the rod and show that that's pretty much the same as all of these. There is no difference.
Yes.
But because we're talking about this is, I thought this was really interesting. This came up in chat where, I'm on screen. So we're talking earlier about positioning the awesome, right? And Alexica brought this up as being used in airplanes for pilot seats for how they adjust it. So what it is I filled this with mineral oil, and then I just have a valve on here to stop the flow. So if I open it up, the rod will move. I wasn't great about getting all the air out, but it actually does a pretty good job despite the air being in there. So I can take it, to somewhere arbitrary, lock it, and then despite that air, it's really not moving. So the Vacu-Lock's on the end because that's just what I happen to have on that cylinder.
Oh, that's
but
nice.
That's, yeah.
Oh, the air gives it a little bit of
a little cushion.
Cushion, yeah.
But as far as parts, this is like, I mean, I'm sure the airplane version is thousands of dollars. This is $20, right?
Yeah.
Like, so for an awesome reference stand, this actually might be a good way of making adjustments.
Yeah, yeah, that's I really like that.
That's just a test article, but we'll get into it and we'll see how it works. Yeah, so
is that how chair adjustment works?
Except it's got a spring. It's got a spring
that
one way.
With a spring return.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
So double acting with a spring return.
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah.
But if it's not, and you know, go ahead and correct us because we're not always right.
Not always. It's actually quite generous.
Very rarely.
Thank
right.
You.
Okay, so this is definitely, like, there is a vacuum component to when it goes in. Like, I can hear, you have to release the air as it goes in. Come on. Okay. But I have my doubts. I think you might agree with that, that I don't think that the vacuum component to this is quite important.
Well, you could do a quick bit of math and say, how much could the vacuum in theory add to it?
We'll wait. Go ahead.
For me? Oh. if you look at the back of the Vaculock, I'd say this opening is something like 15 millimeters, you know, 3/4 of an inch, half an inch or 3/4 of an inch. And when you're thinking about how much force it takes to draw a vacuum, you know, or when you have a syringe, imagine you have a syringe, you compress it, you block the opening, and then you pull the syringe back. When you do that, you can keep pulling that syringe back, and it doesn't get any harder. So you develop a certain amount of force in the syringe, but then after a certain point, you can keep pulling it back, keep pulling it back. It's not a spring. It's not like compressing air. Pulling a vacuum, you're really only limited by the atmospheric pressure pushing back on the syringe, which is a fixed amount. So once you have almost a full vacuum. I mean, it's an infinite level of vacuum, but for all intents and purposes,
and false vacuums.
Decreasing, decreasing pressures, like exponentially decreasing, right? And so once you've pulled vacuum, you're only fighting atmospheric pressure, which is like 12 psi, 14 psi.
One bar.
One bar. Which just doesn't translate as well, but and I'm not. That shows how not metric I am.
Yeah,
it's operating in pascals, I'm not great with. So if you think about psi, you have 14 psi. If you have 1 square inch opening, the most pressure that can be on there is 14 pounds. And since this opening is less than 1 square inch, the most force that a full vacuum, could apply would be 14 pounds, or at least theoretically, that would be the most. Maybe one other interaction is just that if you start pulling a vacuum, it could potentially compress the material around it a little bit,
okay.
Pull it tighter on it, like a Chinese finger trap, you know, where the act of pulling it out kind of like squeezes the material a bit. That would be, I think,
the only other factor that we
wouldn't be considering. But, so I'm not 100%, but
I don't know if we have enough, paper here to maybe talk about it. We are going to do a little bit of math here, but inside of an air cylinder, you have what it looks like is you have a rod going out, which is the actuation, and you have the gasket here. And so this is called the blind end. And this is called the rod end. The force you can apply by putting in air here is slightly more because you have the square area of this, which happens to be really nice in PSI because it's 1 inch, it's 25 millimeters. So there is slightly less force here because the square area that you're pushing against is diminished by the rod, right? And you did this calculation earlier, do you remember? It's like 0.6?
I think it was 0.6 something. So
okay.
0.61.
Roughly 0.6. Yeah. So if we're going to apply PSI on here. So if I'm going to put 40 PSI, 0.6 of that is what, like 24 pounds?
And just a note for all the viewers, I think we're going to be offering a certification if you watch all of the Teardowns. You know,
this certification for this?
Some
like
sort
we're
of
gonna
like
have some, yeah.
skill accreditation that
oh,
you
yeah.
can put on your resume
yeah.
Or your CV to show that you're certified.
You're now a pneumatics expert.
Sex toy, you know, measurements and Teardown. I think we should have some sort of...
Some sort of pin.
Could we
sex
have
expert,
a
yeah.
Coursera course?
Yeah.
How hard is that to do?
I think we just start uploading videos and we're done.
All right. So if you watch all 10 of this year's Teardowns is my arbitrary number.
I don't think there's that many weeks left, but
well,
we can get it in there.
Yes, and do all of your homework.
Yeah, most
not
important. So, to my left, not shown, is a tank of CO2, so we don't have to listen to a compressor.
I can see it. I promise it's real.
Yeah, it does exist. And I will read out arbitrary numbers as this goes up.
I just had this moment where you felt like a magician or something.
Yeah.
And to my left,
and
nothing
up his sleeve, a screwdriver. So, okay. I think this is all backed off, so I can put some air pressure. Okay, cool. And start bringing it up.
Oh, any guesses? How much force? Has anyone used Vacu-Lock? Is anyone like familiar with firsthand usage with Vacu-Lock? Vacu-Lock is this really interesting system that the idea, I think, is amazing, but because Doc Johnson is the only company that's
making it, it would be great if everybody...
It
yeah.
sucks.
Yeah.
Because all the... Not all. A lot of... Okay. Most of the Doc Johnson products are not silicone.
I don't know. This seems to be silicone. I don't want to wade in on
yeah.
whether or not they're silicone.
We won't
yeah.
quite go there. We haven't really like evaluated this one. But many of them aren't silicone, the vast majority. And the ones that are silicone, it's like, silicone, but it's a little bit oily silicone, you know.
This is super soft, and the detail in the casting is amazing.
A very interesting cast, yeah, it's quite detailed.
If you know who the hand model is, let us know.
We were talking about doing a segment where we track down, like, who did this. Like, I would love to meet the person whose hand this is, you know. Or for other toys, like, who's the person who designed that? Could we find the person who made that design choice? I think it would be a really interesting one. Like,
yeah.
If they first, like, we're talking, like, you know, was this just a hand model? Or is it someone like a fisting expert? You know, I would be curious to know.
Just using a lighter on it.
Yeah,
yeah,
we can, I don't have one handy, but we can for sure do that. But yeah, so that's my complaint about the Doc Johnson system. It's just that because it's proprietary to them, doesn't really have...
It'd be great if everybody poured their toy with it.
Exactly. Like, if there was a universal system that everyone added, because it's a pretty easy feature to include.
Yep.
Then we could have, like, this really nice system of compatible toys of whatever...
It'd be a lot easier for stuff like the awesome.
Yeah. Of whatever quality, size, shape you want without having to be limited to whatever Doc Johnson has.
So, do we have any guesses on the number of pounds?
Or kilograms? Or newtons?
Yeah. I think we should go...
A real unit, of course.
Price is Right.
Okay.
Rules for the gift card to Terrible Toy Shop.
Oh,
yeah. We have a prize to give away
if
anyone wants to make a guess.
What is the prize? Tell us about the prize.
$50 gift card.
We need the music.
The $50 gift card.
Music playing. And today.
To a very good friend's store. It's called
Terrible Toy Shop.
Yeah, check them out, guys. TerribleToyShop.com.
.com now. Yeah.
It used to be .ca
now. .com. Yeah.
Really cool. Originally from the Kinky Makers group, actually.
Yeah.
3D printed all kinds of stuff.
All types of
mostly
terrible
toys.
Yeah.
So I think that pretty accurate shop name there.
Again, our group doesn't seem to do well with making flowery names for anything.
We're lacking a finesse design elements to the group. But.
So, okay. I'm gonna start going on this. Hope somebody has a vote in.
Well, if it has anyone, just by the way, as soon as we do this, the contest will be closed, I guess, right?
So we're at 20 psi on the gauge. I think it's
anyone who guessed less than that?
Yeah.
We had one guess for 30-ish pounds.
Okay.
How does Price is Right work again?
Lower without going over.
About 350.
About 350.
All right.
Okay, 30 pounds. Now that's gauge pressure. That's not pull out. There's, Okay, so it's slipping.
A little bit of friction, yeah.
Yeah. Still at 40. It's stuck. Do you want me to... There we go. So, we're still at 40, and it's... Oh, no, it's slipping.
Oh, yeah. That. There we go.
There we go.
So, what do you call it?
About 40 PSI. So, okay. Times 0.6.
Oh, yeah. 4 times 6 is 24.
24 pounds.
24 pounds. Oh, wait. Oh, no. So, price is right. You can't go over.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
Unfortunate.
The good news is there's three more things to test.
Yes.
So, you will have three more tries. And I believe the next one we're going to include a set of free steak knives, is what I heard.
Is that what we're doing?
Or was it a car?
It's a car!
Was it a car?
Yeah.
I thought that was Wheel of Fortune.
Was it your car?
My car.
I think it's a Nissan Micra.
Something
small.
Wow. So, yeah.
Thank you to our sponsors at Nissan. That's just a joke, guys.
Please don't hold us to it.
We're all friends here.
Yeah. That went in easier.
But the gift card is real, so if you want to guess what is in there now, sorry, James?
Vacuum lock, but 3D printed. So same shape. Same general shape. It doesn't have the hard ridges here, so it's got a little bit of a... It's more like this, so it's just for 3D printing. It's easier to print.
Okay. So...
Sorry, on the other side.
3D printed, vacuum lock, non-vented.
Yeah.
All right. Price is right again. I didn't
we have
this.
One for 48 PSI.
48 PSI.
48 PSI.
And just as a reminder,
20 pounds.
The last one was 24
pounds
of force.
Yes.
Which is about 10 kilograms. Oh.
40 PSI. Well, I'm just writing it down. Yeah, okay. Cool. Okay, here we go. Okay, so a little bit of movement around 20. Same thing happened, it just tightened up. It's starting to look like it wants to slip at 30.
Oh.
Yeah, 40. Now it was a lot quicker at 40 PSI, right? I think we got almost, you know what? 38 PSI.
38?
Yeah.
Oh, you went over!
So, okay. So, it definitely slipped a lot more.
Wait, so that was like 23 pounds.
Something like
maybe.
That. Yeah. Want to record that?
Yeah.
Yeah, anywhere. Anywhere.
Fine.
Melissa, do we have anybody to thank who's followed us during this stream?
Followers? We have many followers.
Ah. I need to change this out.
We are currently up to 22 followers on our Twitch channel.
Amazing.
Wow. Thank you all.
Maybe we'll just do a raffle for all the people who followed us for the prize.
Oh, so...
Or I was also thinking, I've been keeping track of user engagement, people who ask questions.
Didn't someone guess 20 pounds on the last one? No?
Maybe.
Okay.
Let's check tape.
What was it actually?
23 pounds.
I have channel locks here at some point during the day.
Yes, right under there. Something.
Right here. Rusty old channel locks. I don't think that's gonna. Okay, so this is vented vacuum lock shape.
Yeah, 3D printed vented vacuum lock.
So this should be roughly the same as what we had here, like 23 pounds, if the vacuum
does not affect it.
Yeah. We should probably do like 3 or 4 of these
That's
each,
true.
But
yeah.
You also probably don't want to watch us do scientific rigor.
That's better fast forwarded on
yeah.
YouTube video.
Okay, so 20 psi and it starts to engage. 30, it's still holding. I'll slowly approach. 38, this is where the last one let go. There's 40.
Hmm.
So, a little bit quicker at 40, but like
yeah.
it's actually hitting 40, between 30 and 40.
Yeah, wow.
I mean, to me, this and this were no different.
Yeah,
in how that
with
went
an
out.
Error. I mean, this is not a super scientifically rigorous test setup.
Are you insulting? Are you insulting this test setup here?
I don't think it's an insult. It's just a comment on the reality
on,
of our
on the accuracy of how poorly put together.
Poor is a relative term. What was the goal? So that was again 24 pounds. So 3D print versus real Vaculok. I do think there was a bit of a difference the way it disengaged.
The Vaculok was sitting at 40 PSI for a long time before it let go.
Yeah.
And then once this let go, I think is what you were getting at, it kind of
just
shot
yeah,
out. Bummed. And that probably has to do with the fillet
I
on here.
I would guess that as well, yeah.
Right. So if I could print that with supports and no fillet,
yeah,
probably
possibly also the friction of this material. This real Vaculok is very smooth. There's a lot of surface contact as it engages the silicone, whereas 3D printed surface is much more textured, so there's less surface contact area. And yeah, and that, so but very interesting. Honestly, that's a lot closer than I thought it would be. I thought there'd be some variation. But
yeah.
At first glance, it would seem you're completely correct. There's zero vacuum effect.
At least not the 14 pounds.
Certainly
theoretical.
Not the
yeah.
14 pounds that could be applied. And now the Great Canadian Double-Double.
Double-Double.
Which is a slang Canadian, North American, mostly Canadian term for a coffee with two creams and two sugars. I always forget to explain that to people who don't live in Canada.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not a global term. So that was sort of like the... I think these are also the diameter of toonies, right?
Each one of these loads
loonies?
Is a toonie.
A toonie, which is a $2 Canadian coin.
And the other cool thing we did here is it has the ability to slide a tube through either a cum tube or a vibrator or whatever you... Come
air,
up with.
Yeah, whatever you
yeah.
want to.
A light sensor? I don't know. Like,
yeah.
yeah.
What about a small, what's the word I'm looking at? Endoscopic camera?
Yeah.
Or just
whatever
a light.
Need. Yep.
You know, like a light for finding,
navigating,
yeah. I can see that being useful.
So I think where this may get a false advantage is I think that this is slightly larger diameter than the lobes.
Okay.
Definitely fighting it a lot more. And actually, that vent hole, I don't know if you've heard that, but it released a little bit of air as it
yeah.
went in. So that might have helped a little bit getting it in.
It is kind of funny. The vacuum effect does seem to be apparent when you're inserting the Vaculok.
Yeah.
Just not when as much when you're removing it.
So, oh, that held it. Yeah, about 10 psi. And, okay, so that's... shifting but hasn't let go. So there's 30. Shifting but hasn't let go. We'll go up, so I'll go half the distance to 40.
We're guessing 15-ish pounds?
For the double
maybe,
double?
Maybe 20 for the double double.
Okay.
I would say it's
does
flipping.
That is moving.
Moving,
still.
Yeah, now.
Yeah,
so
I think that's
still a little bit less, we'll call it. Yep. 36.
We'd like to see what the hole in the toy looks like. Is it smooth or vacuum
sure.
shape?
Okay.
No, this is an official vacuum lock. It's they have this, like, the pour is not, this is not the highest quality end I've seen to one of their vacuum lock toys. It is rough. We can see that on camera.
But yeah, generally the vacuum locks are all shaped.
It matches inside what's,
yeah,
what this
to
is.
Some extent. I'm
yeah.
not exactly sure what the fit tolerance is like.
Yeah.
But it is not just a smooth hole in sort of the shape.
I just noticed on this one how it seems to be like over poured, right?
Here, I'll
I'll feel it on camera for
yeah.
you.
Yeah.
Does that help? Does that
can
help?
You describe can it? You... Can you close your eyes and describe
okay,
it?
Okay, yes.
Does it
as
feel
I
stepped?
Insert my finger.
Oh my God.
Smooth at the end.
Yeah.
Smooth like
can
that.
You give, can you read out diameter?
Mm. It's got a 7 millimeter radius on the end. Actually, comes down and tapers off sort of like a hat. Like if you were wearing a hat.
Can you describe it in flavors of cheese?
I don't really like a lot of flavors of cheese. But interestingly, the first step...
Is it a light beer?
I should...
8%?
If you're actually describing...
I'll
yeah,
try.
Yeah.
With my eyes closed. Okay, so we start at the tip. It comes down. Moves out, but... So it... Then it starts to taper out, and there's a bit of a hook effect here. Like that. And then comes back out to the second phalange, which feels sharper than the first. And I think that's it. And then there's this section. So this is my description of these scoop a little heavier than I think.
You think that's room for air?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure, but that's my description. I hope you all enjoyed
close
that.
Your eyes, answer your fingers.
That would be an interesting project. Is
to see who describes it differently.
No, but so imagine it's a box or something you put your hand or a finger into, and then inside the box you can't see what's happening, but there's a set of actuators and sensory.
You're
motor.
Definitely right. There's a lot of scooping going
yeah,
on in there.
It's scoopy.
Like making room for the. For the edges on the back of the box.
Yeah, but imagine a box you can put your hand in but you can't see, and then it like gives you a sensory experience, or someone else controls that, or like two people put their hands into the box and it like mimics
a handshake.
Feel it.
A handshake.
A blind handshake.
Yeah,
I see where you're going with this.
Something like that.
I'm intrigued.
Well, I prepare this one. Any other?
Yeah, I think this is the final test for today, right?
Yeah.
So anything you guys have, this will, after this, we'll probably be close to wrapping it up. And closing things out. This has been super fun. Thank you all. We love you. This is amazing.
Go for about an inch.
Okay. One in row.
Well, I think, like, you know, rough. A little bit over.
Perfect.
Very scientific.
Yes.
Let's see how ball of tape does versus vacuum. Uh-oh. So, first of all, getting it in there. So.
Something seems... Oh, it's much shorter.
It's shorter, yeah. Let me just add some stiffness here to help push against. Maybe I got it in the second spot. Okay. So,
if you want to cut the zip ties, I could
hold it. Okay, 20. Are we still on? 30, and it's slipping. 32.
Okay.
So
18 pounds?
19, yeah. Yeah, 19.2, right? So not a huge difference. So if you can't afford a vacuum lock adapter or don't have a 3D printer, I guess ball of tape?
Ball of tape, not bad.
Ball of tape. Miss Producer.
All right.
Did we have any follow-up questions?
Anything?
A quote from last stream. We're idiots on the internet. Don't listen to us.
Yes.
That's ridiculous. We've never seen something like that.
I believe also don't operate us, this podcast, within 6 feet of other humans.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, if you're human, don't watch this.
Yeah.
We're not lawyers. Any of these things.
We're definitely not lawyers.
I'm not a patent lawyer.
but, I mean, I guess... thank you everybody for hanging out. Like, it really means a lot to us.
Yeah, any last second questions?
Yeah, we do this
once every 3 weeks.
Every 3 weeks, and we do it to sort of build community and try and help people and make interesting stuff. So if there's anything you want to see or think we could do, we're super open to hearing that. We like doing this, but we make this content to engage with.
Yeah, I mean, maybe we might be doing this on our own, but, you know, then pictures don't get shared on the internet and the interaction, it's not there.
Also, does anyone have any recommendations? Like, what do you want to see on the next stream? What should we tear down next? Tell me.
I think we're trying to do, we said we were going to do this week Violet Wands and tear those down. There was a little bit of a shipping delay on a couple of options that we found that I didn't know existed.
Hello.
Again, you mentioned, so quick tip before we get to that is the facial exercisers or whatever they call them.
Yeah, facial stimulating tool or something.
Are the exact same thing. It's a violet wand, but cheaper.
You get them on Amazon for $50.
Yeah, if you try and buy a violet wand from a sex store, it's much more expensive than if you buy one that is for facials, and health and beauty.
So we found some other tips and gas options in that looked interesting. Might not look interesting on camera, but we're gonna wait to next time to check that out. But we're also gonna have some room to test a couple other things. So anything you want to see taken apart. I know everybody wants to see the big expensive toys. We're gonna have to work on getting some of those in here. You said there was a new IOBA you have or don't have?
I have the new IOBA toy on the way. Yeah. So I think we'll do maybe an IOBA special.
Okay. Yeah, I think we should redo the other IOBA toy
as
well, because that was for a specific crowd, not our regular stream.
Yeah, we did that on Sex Tech Hackathon. Yeah.
Early in the year, which is amazing. Yeah. If one of those happens again, definitely do join.
Yeah, I would highly recommend. That was Alice at Touchy Feely Tech who put that on, who is also amazing.
Yeah, shout out to Alice at Touchy Feely Tech.
Yeah,
we love you.
We missed you. Where have you been?
And, so the IOBA toys really neat. They used stepper motors, which is the first sex toy I've ever seen like that. Stepper motors, and
hey,
I think...
Hey, don't give hints.
The new toy might be similar. we'll redo that first teardown, and then we'll tear down their new toy. So one is a G-spot stimulator with this sort of, finger hook action, and the other is some sort of clit stimulator with, a rotating bead kind of mechanism.
Somebody's waving goodbye.
Goodbye!
But thank you very much for joining. It really means a lot to us, and I guess we got to do that like, comment, subscribe stuff now.
Smash that like button.
Think this is cool, feel free to share this or just come check out the next ones. It's Open Arousal and the Kinky Makers Discord. Come say hi on there. Check that out if you're interested.
We'll have to plug Research and Desire at some point.
I have a company called Research and Desire, and this is sort of part of its mission as well, is helping people explore and play. And if you're into deep throat training, come check us out. That's our first sort of launch product you can purchase. So we're sort of we want to contribute to this, making resources and data collection, and then offer some kind of cool Wi-Fi connected doors.
Great. So, thank you very much, and see you in 3 weeks, hopefully.
Yeah, have a good afternoon. Morning or night, wherever you are.
Thank you. I think you have hit end stream. Very awkward. On the other screen.